Good morning, everybody. Isn't it great that we can come and meet with the Lord this morning together? You know, we can meet with God anytime we want during the week, and many of you are very faithful to do that, but there is something very powerful, very special, very important when we do it as a group, together as the family of God. And that's why we're here today, joining here in live worship, 108 Lee Street, and those that join with us by way of the internet, we welcome you as well. We're gathering here to meet with our Father that He may speak to us, that He may transform us, His ministry may take place in our life so we may do His ministry in the days to come. Our youth have a presentation they want to make. Oh, sorry. You used the A word.
Can you do us a favor and close your eyes? Now think of the woman or women that have led the most impact on your life. Get a picture of her in your head. Now say a prayer of thanks to God for all that she has meant for you.
We would love to know about her too. Give us a chance by telling us about her in our first ever Mother's Day tribute.
Stop by the table in the fellowship hall and fill out a tribute form. You can even submit a picture.
Hey, what an awesome idea for a Mother's Day gift.
And here's something else even more awesome. All the money we collect will help our youth have some amazing summer experiences.
We will see you after the service at the tribute table.
I want to thank everybody who served yesterday. We had an incredible day of serving. It was in many facets, sections, whatever you want to call it. It was great. Those of you who had given of your 40 days, 40 things you gave to the church, also those that gave financially to our church, were able to be at the Chickasaw Market and share free snow cones with people in the name of Jesus. And then here, right out here to my right, we had tables, racks all set up, and just had a free yard sale. Never done anything like this before, but it provided a wonderful opportunity to meet people, to talk to people, to interact with people in the community in a very, very positive way. It was incredibly, incredibly positive. Thanks. I want to thank everybody who served in the different ways. We had a wonderful time. Both at the Chickasaw Market and here at 108 Lee Street, serving people, loving people yesterday, no strings attached. Please, if you haven't already gotten a copy of the bulletin, get a copy of the bulletin, or for those of you online, find it on the website. Take a good look at the insert, a lot of great things going on in our church. We have two meetings today, the Staff Parish Relations Committee meets at 4 o'clock today, and Missions Outreach meet immediately after the service, after the 11 o'clock service, 12:15. You've got to be with us next Sunday. It's going to be a very, very special Mother's Day. Let's turn our hearts and minds to the Lord. Let's worship the Lord singing from our hearts.
Let's stand together and sing, "Open Up the Heavens."
Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, We're so glad we're celebrating Jesus today, celebrating his love, his life, his story on our hearts. Let's continue as we sing Jesus, lover of our soul. Jesus, lover of my soul.
Please be seated. As we go to prayer today, we've a number of things we need to pray for with our church. One of the things is our exciting month of May. If you haven't received your church newsletter, I got mine Friday. You should be getting yours any day now. And please read it. It's a lot of great photographs, great news, wonderful things. To my left, those of you online can't see it, we have a prayer wall there we used on our Good Friday service. We've decided to leave it up. And if you have a prayer need or a word of thanksgiving, you want to take a few minutes and especially share it with God, it is there. Also, over there, we have our continuing Easter egg outreach reminders. If you talk to someone about Jesus or our church, write their name, their initials on one of the eggs and put it in there. We want to fill that container up of gospel conversations the Lord is allowing us to make. And finally, we have a round table there with Bibles on it. Now we've even got photographs to help us know who our seniors are that we are wanting to encourage. Where these are the Bibles we'll be giving out the Sunday after Mother's Day to our seniors. Take a few minutes and fill out a Bible. Take a Bible, find one of your favorite verses, highlight it, and write your name beside it so that they, years from now, will remember you. And your life and your faith will inspire these graduating seniors from our church. So please take a few minutes today, tomorrow. Those of you online, you can come up to the church anytime during the week. You can call Renee, and she'll make sure we get you in, and you can take some time to do it. I know some of you are very conscientious about this, and I really, really appreciate it. So if you want to come during the week and it's going to take you an hour, that's fine. Come on up here. We'll even get you a chair and sit down and really give yourself to this task. This is an important means of communicating our faith from one generation to the next. As we go to prayer today, we actually have a large number of prayer needs that are before us. Some of these I was able to visit with. Some of them I wasn't. I hope to visit with them later on. Barbara Trout is in Gulf Coast Rehab. I had a wonderful visit with her Thursday. The rehab experience seems to be really helping her, and we celebrate that and want to just pray for her to continue to go forward. Sam Rawls, who's J.R. Rawls' father, is in Spring Hill Hospital having some difficulties. I went by to see him yesterday, late afternoon, but their visiting hours cut off early on Saturday. I'm going to try to see Sam today, but we want to pray for Sam and J.R. and Renee and all of them. Also pray for Lynn Lett. I was talking with Lael this week. She has some medical decisions she is needing to make, and we want to pray for those. We want to also continue to pray for some that are struggling with some ongoing health issues. Without going into all the details, Sheila Kirksey, Betty McLarty, Rolf Snaves, also David Caton, someone who's been a part of our church, moved to Citronelle, has moved back to Chickasaw, and he is in USA Medical Center. I saw him yesterday. He's having some extreme problems with his right foot, and we'll pray for his recovery. Also, we want to pray for the seeds that were planted yesterday and our outreach, missions, events we did yesterday. We made a lot of positive connections with people we've never met before. And it was really cool that we made positive connections with people we knew. But due to just not seeing each other, we hadn't had much chance to talk. And there was just some wonderful visiting that went on even within our family. So we want to pray for those seeds that were planted. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Lord, our King, our Father, our God, who is more powerful than gravity, more powerful than time, we come before you now. And we ask that you would see us as we are. Help us to see us as we are. And Lord, we ask that you would forgive us. But more than that you would simply forgive us, we ask that you would change us. You would work in our midst, and each of us individually, that we may be transformed, that our thinking, our living, our loving will be changed by your work in our lives. We need more than just a second chance. We need the Spirit's power to use the second chances you give us very, very well. Lord, we are a diverse group of people here. Many different backgrounds, many different situations, many different families, many different struggles. And Lord, we call out to you now that you would minister to each of us individually, that you would help us, that we would know the power of your love and grace in each of our lives. We pray for our friends that are having difficult times these days. We want to lift Barbara Trout up to you, Sam Rawls, that you would minister to him and help him do both to these people, do better. They could go home soon. We pray for Lynn Lett that you will give her wisdom with these medical decisions. Ongoing cancer treatments can be very confusing and very, very tiring. Help our friend Lynn out, Lord. Lord, we do also want to continue to pray for Sheila Kirksey and Betty McLarty and Ross Nays with the challenges they're facing in their life. We pray for David Caton that his foot will heal and that he'll be back with us soon in worship. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to serve others yesterday, to just show your love to people without putting any strings to it, just being gracious and good the way you are to us. Lord, we pray for these positive connections we made and that you will help these opportunities to flourish, to bloom. We pray for these that we connected with and word and deed yesterday, that they will continue to think about what they heard and what they felt, And if it be your will that they become part of our family, that we will be able to bring them into this family called Chickasaw Methodist Church, and they would also be able to experience the power and the love that has been a part of our lives as being a part of this family. Lord Jesus, we just ask that you will use this time together well. Use it for your glory and your kingdom in each of our lives. May the preaching, the singing, and the communion be rich with your grace. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So we go to offering today. We want to continue to serve the Lord with our minds, our bodies, with our gifts, and we give these gifts now to God that he may take them, multiply them, and continue to teach us not only that he is the Lord of our lives, but he is the provider of all good things that we have in our life. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our gracious Lord, our King, we give you these gifts in faith. We ask that you will receive them, you will bless them, and most of all, that you will use them to do what you want to do here in Chickasaw and ultimately throughout the whole world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Elise. Thank you, Carol. This time I want to invite those younger folks to come over for a few minutes with me. And Jordan's over here to greet you as always. Good morning. I was met with some misfortune this week that the magic I ordered did not come. So I want to talk about what makes a magic trick a magic trick. Yeah?
It's not real.
It's not real, but you expect something to happen, and then something else happens. And I got thinking this week about this, though. There are certain things that always happen that show the hand of God in our world, in our life, that He loves us so much. He sets so many things into motion. Recently, I was on the Chickasaw Creek, and I went under a bridge, and there were all these birds, lots of birds, flying around this bridge. And as I slowed the boat down and looked at it more closely, I realized two things. Number one, they were all the same kind of bird. Yeah, they were all the same. It was like the bird club of this kind of bird were all here in one place. But the second thing was this, was that they all had made the same kind of nest on the underside of the bridge. It was about this, about the size of my fist, a little bit bigger maybe. A little pocket, a little house made of mud. And the mud had dried and formed each of these birds' little homes, and they had a little hole, and they were flying into the in and out of the holes. And I thought, who taught those birds how to do that? They just knew. And now, like if you said to me, Dave Rhodes, you need to build yourself a house out of mud that you can live in that's just the same size as you. Yeah, I couldn't do that. I have to study and learn and read, but the birds know. The birds know. I like collecting things, and here's a bird nest that I saved a few years ago. You know, most all birds make their, each kind of bird makes their nest differently than the other birds. Blue jays make different than cardinals. And who told them to do that? They were just made that way by God. You know, even this is kind of sad. There's some birds that are bullies, and they steal other birds' nests. They're too lazy to make their own nest, and they go take another bird. But they just know this. But what's even more amazing to me is bugs. This is a wasp nest. It was actually bigger. It's part of it's dying. It's falling apart. I was stung by some of the people that made their home, the bugs that made their home in it, and I found it later after I had killed them. It was one of the biggest ones I'd ever seen. It's falling apart, so you can't tell. But if you can look at it, you see there's all those little chambers they have? And those aren't circles. They're hexagons. They're perfectly mated six-side shapes. Who taught the bugs to make a hexagon hole? Not a square, not a circle, six-sided shape, hexagon. Amazing. God has showed His love to us so many ways that we live in such a beautiful, well-ordered world that we can even look at the bugs, and the bugs know how to do things. But even more than all these, God wants His love to be in each of us. God has loved the world in very general and open and big, big ways. But then for you and you and you and me, God has special love for us because we're people. And it's our journey, our life's journey as we go through life to discover God's love for you specifically. Let us pray. Lord, we thank You that You love this, love our world. And You love even the bugs and the birds. But even more than the bugs and the birds, You love us as people. Help each of us to know and receive that amazing love You have for us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, you guys head out with Ms. Jordan now to continue learning about the love of God. I would like to invite you, if you have your Bibles with you, to turn to Numbers chapter 14. Numbers chapter 14, we will begin with verse 1. Numbers, this is a book of the Bible, I fear, has been given a bad reputation. It has been labeled by many as a boring book of the Bible because it begins with census. long list of names we can't pronounce. And then it's followed up by some instructions, very detailed instructions about things. But if you hold on past the number, the census numbers, and the detailed instructions, and you get further in, Numbers has some of the most amazing stories, I really think, of any book in the Bible. They're fascinating. In some ways, they're even just a little bit funny because they're so absurd what some of the things that people do there. And it's easy to laugh that off, but God's calling us to see ourselves in this story. And so we're going to look at a story here from Numbers chapter 14. This is in chapter 13. God has given the people an opportunity and challenge, and this is their response to what God has told them, beginning with verse 1. By the way, if you don't have a Bible, just listen. This story flows very, very smoothly. That night, all the members of the community raised their voices and wept aloud. All the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, "If only we had died in Egypt or in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us out to this land to only let us fall by the sword? Our wives and our children will be taken as plunder. Wouldn't it have been better to go back to Egypt?" And they said to each other, "We should choose a leader and go back to Egypt." Then Moses and Aaron fell down in front of the whole assembly and gathered there. Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, were there among those who explored the land, and they tore their clothes, and they said to the entire Israelite assembly, "The land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us into that land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and he will give it to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will devour them. Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them." But the whole assembly talked about stoning them. This is really escalating. Then the Lord, glory of the Lord appeared in the tent and to all the Israelites. Then the Lord said to Moses, "How long will these people treat me with contempt? How long will they refuse to believe in me in spite of all the signs I have performed among them? I will strike them down with a plague and destroy them, but I will make you into a nation greater and stronger than they." Moses said to the Lord, "Then the Egyptians will hear about it. By your power you brought these people out from among them, and they will tell the inhabitants of the land about it. They have already heard that you, Lord, are with these people, and that you, Lord, have seen seen face to face, and your cloud stays over them, and that you go before them in a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. If you put all these people to death, leaving none of them alive, the nations who have heard this report will say about you, 'The Lord was not able to bring these people into the land he promised them on oath. So he slaughtered them in the wilderness.' Now, may the Lord's strength be displayed just as you have declared. The Lord is slow to anger, abounding in love, and forgiving sin and rebellion. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes children for the sin of the parents of the third and fourth generation. In accordance with your great love, forgive the sin of these people just as you have pardoned them from the time they left Egypt until now." The Lord replied, "And I have forgiven them as you ask." So this is a story about the love of God that I'm going to share with you that is all full of stories of judgment. Stay with me to the end. Because there's two problems coming into the story that a lot of us as modern Americans in the year 2021, we do not understand. We do not realize this. The first is that we are a sinful, selfish, and finite people, and God is a holy, loving, and infinite God. Now, isn't that about the most negative way to start a sermon in the world? I mean, I'm not coming on Mother's Day if he's this bad the week before Mother's Day. Let's look at this verse. There's something I want you to get about yourself. I want you to get about people. Jeremiah 17:9. "The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it?" Focus in there on the word deceitful Or in the Living Bible, it said, the heart is the most deceitful thing there is and desperately wicked. No one can really know how bad it is. Deceitful. If you've studied history, there's a lot of sad stories of what people have done to each other. And you raise this question, what? How could have they done this? How could have they been okay with this group doing this to another group? Or, and maybe in human relationships you've had, where you've grown close to someone, you work with someone, and all of a sudden they do something you just really can't believe. And you, maybe you even had to say to that person, how could you do that? See, that shows the deceitfulness of the human heart. People who do whatever they do, if you ask them about it, they've always got some reason. Or even stranger, there's those who have been, you know, videotaped committing violent crimes. And they'll say, oh no, that wasn't me. I wasn't there. Deceitful. Our hearts want to deceive us. One of the biggest challenges God has in working with us is helping us to see ourselves and receive from Him what He wants us to have. Because God truly is a holy, loving, and infinite God. Every one of us here have been late for something in our lives. Maybe even very frustrated that we're late. You know, God is more powerful than time. He can move it backwards. He can move it forward. You get in the future, He's already been there. He's also in the past, and He's here with us right now. Our Lord is truly, truly amazing. And then the second thing, and then we see this in our lives, we see this is one of the core problems these people we're going to look at in the story have. That if you want to be free of a difficult circumstance, you must change. Period. End of story. And you cannot be in two places at one time. Again, I might just be saying the most obvious thing. See, we're going to look at these people, the children of Israel, the Hebrew people, and we're going to see they did not want to be slaves. The Egyptians were terrible. There's been many forms of slavery through history. I think this may have been some of the worst slavery ever done was what the Egyptians did. That's when they have the pyramids over there. They enslaved thousands, maybe millions of people to build these complicated buildings just to bury their kings in. Crazy, isn't it? And these people were living a terrible life. And they didn't want to be slaves anymore. But for them to be free, they had to change. And they couldn't understand that. They never really got it, I'm convinced, in this story. What we need to many times do is first seek to be content in our situation, because that's a change, before we want our situation to change. Some of you may be struggling with this very thing right now. You want things to be different, but you don't want to change. And for things to be different in any situation, you have to change. Okay, let's go through this story real quickly. It's Numbers 14. I'm going to walk you through it pretty quickly, but it's a pretty straightforward story here. When the people have heard back from the spies spying out the promised land, they complained. Every one of us has had people to complain to us. And it'd be really fun. We could start with Elise, go all the way to Derry and say, what is the longest someone ever complained to you? It might be scary. Some of you might say years. But the people complained all night long. They did. I mean, they're really mad. When someone is too mad to go to bed and all they want to do is just keep griping at you, they are really, really mad. And then God in His mercy gives us the content of their complaints. Verse 2, they say, if only we had died in Egypt or in this wilderness. God has mistreated us so, so badly, we would be better dead. There's an extremely high level of discontentment here. And the people actually are so angry, they become disillusional. They begin to think fantasies that are completely untrue. They say there in verses 3 and 4, why is the Lord bringing us out of the land only to let us fall by the sword? Our wives and children would have been taken as plunder. Wouldn't it have been better for us to go back to Egypt? And they said to each other, we should choose a leader instead of Moses and go to Egypt. Now, what was waiting for them in Egypt? Slavery. But not only was slavery waiting on them, they had drowned their army in the Red Sea. And then they had brought these 10 terrible plagues on the people. They're not going to be happy to see them if they come back. But they have let their anger overtake them so strongly, they're not even thinking straight. You know, that happens to us sometimes. We get so mad, we're not even thinking straight, and we have to calm down first. What are Moses and Aaron doing? These two guys, these two men are so frustrated, they're just laying on their faces praying. they're past talking. They are just given up with the situation, and they just fall down on their faces, praying to God to help them out. Two people speak up for God and for Moses and Aaron here, and it is Joshua and Caleb, the two of the spies who went into the land and came back out of the land in faith. And they say there, if you pick up the middle of the slide, or the Lord, land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will give it to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not be afraid of the people of the land, because he will devour them. Their protection is gone, and the Lord was with us. Do not be afraid of them. Can you hear the stress in the voice of Joshua and Caleb crying out to the people, please, please, please don't go down this road you're on. Please, please listen to the Lord. He will give us that land. Now, why do these two men have so much faith? I don't know exactly, but I do know they had seen the plagues. They had seen the Red Sea. They had seen the manna. They had seen the quail. They had seen all the other incredible provision that God had given them. And they made a simple assumption. If God provided for us then, surely he will provide for us now and on into the future. But we will have to change. Now, the hostility gets so bad they're ready to kill Moses and Aaron. The whole assembly began to talk about stoning them, taking rocks and killing Moses and Aaron. This is a lot of anger here, folks. Now it says, then the glory of the Lord appeared at the tent of the meeting to all the Israelites. God intervenes, and this is very bad news for these people. Well, if you're not familiar with the story of the Exodus, that they traveled as a large group, they set their tents up, and they had encampments of the 12 tribes. But off to the side, outside of the camp, there was another tent. No one slept in that tent. It was God's tent. And a cloud-like would come down over the tent, and that let the people know that God wanted to speak to Moses, and Moses would go inside the tent, and they would talk to each other. And so at this point, they're just so mad at God, and then they see the cloud come down over their tent, and they realize God was intervening. I would say scarcely a week of my life doesn't go by that I don't hear someone tell me they wish God would intervene in one situation or another. And I pray for God to intervene too. But then sometimes, though, when God intervenes, you're not God and I'm not God. He is totally separate from us. And if he intervenes, he may want you to change. He may call your habits, not just the person you're mad at, he may call you into question too. Be careful about calling God to come and intervene. So what does God say? The Lord appeared to Moses and he says, how long will these people treat me with contempt. How long will they refuse to believe in me in spite of all the signs I performed among them? Contempt. The people are treating God with contempt. What does that mean? Without telling you the whole story of the Exodus, three problems. They complained and complained and complained and complained. Let's have a show of hands. Who enjoys being around people who complain in this room? Nobody. Now, I know sometimes people will say, I don't want to complain to God. It's how you complain to God or what your motivation is. If you have a problem and you try to hide it inside yourself, God knows it's there. God is not stupid. That sounds so trite to say that. But God knows your thoughts. You maybe have heard some of the teachers say, you can't say these kind of sentences. God already knows what you're thinking. Your best bet is to say it, but don't stay there. Don't stay in that negative, critical way of looking at God, looking at life, looking at people. God is a positive, optimistic, loving, gracious God, and He wants us to be that way as well. They got stuck in a cycle of thinking and never got out of it. Number two, they didn't listen to God. God told them things and they wanted to argue with Him all the time. And worst of all, when God gave them opportunities, they said God would not help them. They said it's impossible. The assumption is God is wanting to help them. So here is the most severe judgment I think God ever was about to do to the people of Israel. He's going to kill them all. A-L-L. Yeah, I'm going to strike them, all of them, down with a plague. And I will make you, Moses, into a nation. All out of you. It's like, I'm tired of these people. I'm starting all over. Moses prays. This story looks a little bit strange, especially in English, that it seems like Moses is more patient than God is. I'm told by a person in particular who studied Hebrew extensively, say there is a bargaining grammar here you're not getting in English. It's kind of like this. When your children are small, you can't give them certain things. They can't manage it. But then they get a little older and you want to give it to them. But you don't want to seem like, you know, the marshmallow pushover parent. So at least I do this. And I hope I'm not the only one here. That you set the situation up where you bring up this topic. So they'll ask you for it. But not only will they ask you for it, they have to explain to you why they should have it. And I know for me, it's a real joyous experience as a parent I'll bring it up and they say, well, you know, that allowance you're giving is, and I've had this conversation, is not fair. It is impossibly too low. Oh, really? Yeah, it's sure. Why is it? And they talk. And I've already made up my mind to say yes. But I'm not going to say yes until they ask, until we discuss it. So here is what goes on here. In these verses before us here, God says, Moses says to God, you can't kill them because it's going to make you look bad to the pagan nations. They're going to question you, Yahweh, and you know you don't want to be thought of. They already are in awe of you because you're doing what a God has never done in all of the world. We've never seen anything like this. You do not want to hurt your glory, God. And then Moses goes on to say, God, you are not this harsh. He says, the Lord is slow to anger, abounding in love, forgiving sin and rebellion. How does Moses know more about God than God knows about God? This is something really cool about the story. God tells Moses earlier in Exodus 34, verses 6 and 7, I am slow to anger, abounding in love, forgiving, and patient. And in the moment of crisis, Moses brings this back up to God. Again, God was wanting, it's not coming out in English, but it's God is wanting to do this very thing, but he's waiting for his people to pray. I think that's a lot of true in our lives, true in our world. There's a lot of things God wants to do, far more than we want God to do, but he's waiting for us to abandon our need to be in control and genuinely pray. So God says, I forgive them. It's a major shift in the story. God is like, I'm going to kill them. Moses prays, and God says, okay, I'll forgive them. Gives you a feeling. You know, this is kind of what God wanted to do in the first place. But God says here in verses 21 through 24, there will be consequences. Everyone but Joshua and Caleb will die before they cross the Jordan River. In the next chapter, they try to cross the Jordan River without God, and it is a bitter failure. There always are consequences to our sins. There are damages. Through the years, I've gotten to know some wonderful Christian people that were once drug addicts. God had set them free, and I'm glad they came into my life. But they're no longer here with me. Their liver and their lungs and their kidneys failed from too many harsh chemicals years ago. I pray for those who've been set free that they will be with us as long as possible, but there are consequences. God talked about the bird nest. God has created an ordered world. And then sometimes there's restitution. There are times God calls us to own our sins enough to make restitution. Sometimes it's in a simple apology. Sometimes it's a simple explanation. I think one of the greatest things I ever learned about honesty was when my mother made me pay back the roll of lifesavers I stole when I was 5 years old. It was only a dime, but that taught me a lot. Here's what I want you to hear. Do you believe this, that God's kindness brings us to repentance? We're about to take communion here, and it's a service of repentance. It's a service of forgiveness. But why do you come to God? Because you're afraid of him? Because you're afraid he's going to figure something out about you? Know something about you he doesn't like? Or do you come to God because he's holy, but he's very, very kind? He's very, very loving. Romans 2:4 says it is God's kindness that leads us to repentance. Ask the question, how do you connect with a person? It's the same question, what causes you to love God? Some people sometimes will bring up to me, well, you live for God because you just want to go to heaven. I say, I do really want to go to heaven. I expect to go to heaven. I'm not in a hurry to die, but I really do look forward to go to heaven. But I seek to live for God because I don't want to push God away from me in my life. And what makes heaven a great place is not that it's a great place. It's who is there, God. The way I live, the way I relate to people is because I want to give glory to God and I want God as much a part of my life as spiritually possible for me. I hope that's true for you, that you honor God because he first loved you. He reached out to you. We're going to be turning our attention to the Lord's table now. And Tony's going to come and help me serve here. But I want to give you this invitation. For all of you that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and you intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God, walking with Him, would you now draw near with faith, take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to God? It's on the slide screens here. Let's pray this prayer together. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all people, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For our thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and the glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We have a wonderful tradition here at our church where we take a special offering every Communion Sunday. You can simply leave your gift on the communion rail, or you can put it in the offering box and label it on the envelope, communion rail offering. It helps people out with financial needs. We're in a bind. I want to go ahead and take enough for everybody. Three more. There are people that have a really hard time sometimes. Medical needs, financial needs. They find themselves in a real bind, and your giving allows your church to serve them. So would you consider giving these gifts? Would you take your container, peel off the plastic wrap on the top, and remove the little wafer from inside there? And then go ahead and peel back the purple lid. So at the appropriate time, you may take. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread. After he had thanked the Father for it, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken and given for you. Take the bread now." Lord, we thank you that you gave the richness of your life, your whole body to us, that our lives may be full of your riches that you have for us. Amen. And when the supper was over, he took the cup, again gave a word of thanks, and then gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood, blood of a new covenant, poured out for you, for everyone, for the forgiveness of sins. Remember me as frequently as you drink this." So let us now take the cup the Lord has given to us. Our Lord Jesus, we thank you that you gave your blood for us. The Bible said the lifeblood of a person is in their blood. The life of a person is in their blood. We thank you for how you gave your life for us so that our lives could be spared, that our greatest challenge, our sinfulness, could be forgiven and we could be set free. Lord, we ask that your love will overwhelm us in our time together here, that we will know that we are loved. We are loved in some really big ways. Lord, we need to know more than knowledge, though. We need to experience that love personally, realistically. Lord, give us that gift for our own sake, for the kingdom's sake, and so that we would be free to love you and love others. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. May the Lord bless you richly as you seek to live for him this week. Amen.